Super excited for tonight's show. This is something that I've been looking forward to for our entire trip here. So tonight's guest is David Plotz. So he was born and raised here in Washington, D.C. He was a writer and editor of the Washington City paper for a time. Before that, he joined Slate magazine when they first got launched in 1996. He eventually took over as editor-in-chief from 2008 to 2014. He's now the CEO of Atlas Obscura, but in the meantime, he also wrote no fewer than two books, including The Genius Factory, The Curious History of the Nobel Prize Sperm Bank, and good book, The Bizarre, Hilarious, Disturbing, Marvelous, Inspiring Things I Learned by Reading Every Word of the Bible. Ladies and gentlemen, please, a tremendous round of applause. It's a host thing. I'm not allowed to sit until you sit, I think, is the rule that I live by. Thank you so much for coming here.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Yeah, we're delighted. So there's tons that I wanted to talk to you about and ask you about, and we're going to open it up, I should say, in the second half of the show for questions that you all have of our guests. But I did want to start with you. Relatively recently took over with Atlas Obscura, and I know that we talked a little bit before the show about what Atlas Obscura is, but I still am really interested to hear you sort of what's your elevator pitch, I guess, because I imagine you've been doing that recently.
Oh my god, I've pitched, never actually in an elevator though, that's made up. Atlas Obscura is National Geographic for the 21st century.
Is it National Geographic for the 21st century?
If you look at National Geographic, and I hope there aren't too many National Geographic employees here, but the average age of a National Geographic reader is 113. National Geographic is amazing, it's awesome. It's an incredible venture that it sort of brings wonder to people. But it means a little bit less to younger people, and I think the premise of Atlas Obscura is we are about discovery, wonder, exploration, but we believe that you don't have to be Richard Branson, you don't have to have $10 million, you don't have to go to a Himalaya or to a pole to have an adventure, that wherever you are in the world, around the corner from you is something amazing, marvelous, and inspiring to discover. And so we're gonna build a community of people who are exploring just the world right around them.
So how does that manifest then, I guess? I know that it's a website and that you have user-generated content, but is it that, you know, someone sends their child outside with an iPad and they say, find something, or?
Well, two of my children are here today, so maybe I can send them out now. We don't have an iPad. So part of it is we encourage you as a citizen to look at Atlas Obscura and see what we have, which might be in your neighborhood or might be around the world, just for inspiration. So just read it and be inspired by it. It might be that you're going to Cleveland and you wonder, what's a really cool thing to do in Cleveland that isn't the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
What is a really cool thing to do?
No idea. I have no idea. I didn't look that up. But for example, there's one example I like is the Eiffel Tower would not be an Atlas Obscura, because the Eiffel Tower is pretty well known. But what is an Atlas Obscura is that Gustav Eiffel, the architect of the Eiffel Tower, the engineer who built the Eiffel Tower, built himself a crash pad at 1,000 feet in the Eiffel Tower, his own private little apartment. And you can now, it was sealed off for years, you can now go visit Eiffel's secret apartment at the top of the Eiffel Tower, which he used to bring. He brought Tesla up there once, and he brought, I think Edison came up with him there once.
So is there a threshold of like unknown, like, or is it sort of a hipster thing where once enough people know about it, it's not cool anymore?
You know, there's a question about whether are we going to ruin places by publicizing them, and I think not. I think basically our premise is that we want to show you every interesting, awesome, wonderful, strange place in the world, and it may be that by showing it to you, more people will go there, it'll be less cool for you to be the person who's made the visit to Blood Falls or to Snake Island or whatever it is where you go. But really, it's as long as we get you out there doing it and then also contributing your photographs, your ideas, the places you've been, or going on the events that we sponsor, that'll be fine. And I think if all of a sudden Blood Falls is just mobbed with people, the people of Blood Falls
just take it off the site.
No, we won't. But it's not going to happen. It's in the Arctic. It won't happen.
I have two more Atlas Obscura questions. One is, I don't know how to frame this as a question other than that I read about that you brought a wolf to an event, and I don't know whether to be disappointed or excited that you did not bring a wolf.
We didn't bring a wolf. it was amazing. We had an event at this Brooklyn bar. So Atlas Obscura is based in Greenpoint, Brooklyn, which is, if you have been in Brooklyn, it is like the most mustachioed tattoo place on the planet. But so there was this bar around the corner from our office, and there's a wolf conservation organization that we've done stuff with, and we asked them, can you bring a wolf to the bar? And they brought this wolf.
I like that you asked the wolf sanctuary, not the bar.
The bartenders were slightly irked when the wolf went behind the bar and started lapping up beer and actually got its muzzle around a tap. But it was the moment when the wolf walked in the bar. It was the most silent moment I've ever had in my life. Every single person held their breath, and it was just like, and it was great. The wolf actually it nuzzled around my backpack for a while. That was cool.
So that's a perfect segue into what I wanted to sort of end with, which is almost circling back to what is Atlas Obscura, because on one level it's a business and it's a website and whatnot, but it seems like there's some sort of social mission almost that's beyond that.
Well, our investors don't know that. But the premise is that we want to make everybody an explorer. We want to turn on this nozzle of exploration in your brain and have you suddenly see the world differently and walk through the world differently. But most of all, we want you to be a reader, an event goer, a registered user, a contributor, so that we can monetize the hell out of you, and then our investors get a return, and
we become
a big business. I mean, I don't think there's no. I want this to be a great big business, but the reason I want it to be a great big business is to fulfill this purpose of making people see the world differently. And just, I mean, to answer a question you didn't ask, which is I've been in Washington forever and covering politics in Washington for a very long time, and was editing Slate, which is not entirely a political magazine, but has a lot of politics in it. And it became clear to me in the past few years that this was just a grim subject to be paying a lot of attention to, and it was really depressing. The political stories became so overwhelmingly negative and dysfunctional and horrible. And the thing that I loved about Atlas Obscura is that it's something which is like nonpartisan, has nothing to do with political life. It has to do with how each of us walk through the world and experience the world, and it can make your way of experiencing the world even better. And in fact, I mean, and I had this own, an experience with my daughter who's here, where we went biking down in Anacostia and through the trail that goes through Fort DuPont, Fort Mahan, and Fort Wallace, and Fort Davis. I was like, why is everything a fort? And came back and looked and realized, oh, these were all Civil War, this is the Civil War defenses of Washington. And then the family went out for a walk up by Military Road and Oregon Avenue and you walk into Rock Creek Park, you go a couple hundred yards and then off to the left, take a little trail, and all of a sudden there's this moat and these earthen walls that rise up 15 feet above you, which are all overgrown with trees, but you get on the walls and you realize, this was a ring, this is a ringed wall, which was Fort DeRussy. This is a Civil War fort right in the middle of the city. And I had this moment myself of like, wow, we didn't discover it. It was on the National Park Service website, but it was just so thrilling for me, and I hope for the kids, just to experience this place which had a tremendous history. It was right there where we lived, so that's what I'm going for.
So to follow up, I want to ask you about politics. You prefaced to say that you did find it so sort of depressing, but that was your career for so long, and I think that there's probably a lot of folks here who might know you from doing this Slate Political Gabfest every weekend. So,
yeah.
I do want to ask, you covered politics for at least 15, 20 years. What did it change, or did you change, or did was it some combination of the two?
I think it's changed. I don't think that anyone who's lived in Washington for the last 20 years can pretend it's the same as it was 20 years ago. I mean, I grew up in Washington, so compared to what it was 40 years ago, Boehner's actually resignation puts a nice highlight on this, because Boehner, for all that I as a liberal, could beat him up, Boehner at least is a politician who believes in politics and believes in political process and is somebody who you can actually negotiate with. And what's grim about what's happened in Washington is that it has been taken over by people who fundamentally don't believe in the work that they're supposed to do. They're people who've got this job of legislator, and they don't believe in legislation. They believe in a kind of nihilistic, vituperative anti-government philosophy, and that's made everything completely poisonous in a way that it wasn't 20 years ago. It wasn't, or it certainly wasn't 30 years ago, and it wasn't really even 20 years ago. And it just for me it became. It's just too depressing. Depressing.
I'd love to ask more about Boehner retiring today or announcing that he'll retire. In that very sense, right? I guess the question for a lot of folks that buying this hypothesis is that just sort of another chapter in a progressively Dickensian novel, or is it something that is that some sort of turning point where there's something that happens relatively soon where people are like, wow, this is too much, like, we want to have people who believe in things again.
Well, I mean, the Marxist...
Hey, this is a comedy show, everybody.
The Marxist, the Marxist in me said, says, oh, we're heightening the contradictions, because whoever comes in next, Boehner's problem was that he just refused to be, he refused to have these ridiculous showdowns with the president where he would shut the government down for whatever it is, Planned Parenthood or, the debt ceiling or all these nonsense reasons where they're attempting to kind of destroy the foundations of the government. And whoever comes in next is going to be expected to act more conservatively and more more negatively. And but I don't think that necessarily is going to produce a backlash where people are going to suddenly say, oh, we need to replace it. I think it's just going to make people hate Washington and hate the political process even more. What's amazing to me is if you look at the Republican voters, here you have an economy which is basically on the mend, has been on the mend for 5 years. You have a country that has gotten itself out of most of the wars that it's been involved in. We have a healthcare system which is now at least in clearly somewhat better shape than it's been. And people live longer, they're healthier than they ever have been. And there's this sense that among Republicans that everything is wrong. And everything isn't wrong. And it's so odd, but there's this way that Republican conservative politics is poisoning people and making them think everything is much worse than it is, and that the country is fucked up in a way that it is simply not. And that is, I don't see how that's reparable, really.
So that's a really interesting question then to ask in terms of your business, in terms of the media business, because for that to be true, there either has to be culpability in the media or an active helping in that. And I guess the question would be, is that something, and I think that's maybe self-evident, I don't ask great questions, but in terms of, is that something that has changed over this amount of time? And I guess, does it ever change back, or is it just a sort of asymptote?
Well, I think what we had is that there was this anomalous period from the end of World War II until about 1995, where you had kind of consensus mainstream journalism, which was attempting to be nonpartisan. And it was able to be that way because the networks were so protected, and because the big newspapers had essentially monopoly businesses in their towns on certain forms of advertising, especially classified advertising. So they were hugely profitable, and they could afford this sort of high-mindedness. And with the rise of the internet, and the fracturing of audiences, it suddenly became very useful for certain forms of media to become extremely ideological and to stake out ideological positions. And there's suddenly much more media. So there weren't just three networks. There were suddenly, you know, this flowering of lots of different kinds of networks. And the more political ones, the more ideological ones did better. And similarly with newspapers, there isn't really the place of the non-partisan, we don't take a position kind of holier-than-thou newspaper. We get one of those in the country, which is the New York Times. But basically everybody else has had to is either dying or has had to stake out a much more political sort of position. And certainly all the digital media that's come up is very political. So there are huge market incentives for media to be ideological and to take sides. And that then in turn pushes the public to become much more ideological.
I'm tempted to suggest that the Minneapolis Star Tribune is not as terrible, but it's like people. Thank you. The more interesting question in some ways is the traditional sort of free speech, free market argument would go, the more speech we have, the more democratic and the more free we are. But if we take your two pieces together, it would suggest, no, we're actually getting much worse the more media that we have.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of a free speech absolutist in some sense, but I would not say that the proliferation of speech over the past 20 years and the proliferation of media and the proliferation, in particular, of digital media and sort of cable news has been good for the country. I don't think it's good for the country. I think it's been definitively, it's just made people much more ideological. It's made people care about things they actually don't really care about. And made them get really worked up about stuff that they actually, it just doesn't even matter.
We miss the apathy. That...
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
I get that. One other thing I wanted to ask you about covering these kinds of things and being in Slate is we actually met a couple of years ago. You gave a very good talk in St. Paul, Minnesota, and talked a little bit about how Slate over the years honed having a voice that had a sense of fun to it, and that was very challenging at first, and it got somewhat easier. And I'm curious about sort of checking in 2 years later about how that progression happens. You still feel like that sense of, not just because we do an improv comedy show about public policy, but that sense of fun or lightness about some of these things is something that is continuing to thrive, or has it run its course, or what?
I think it's continuing to thrive. I think it's when Slate started back in the 90s, its voice was very different. It was very conversational at a time when media was not conversational at all. But now everything is conversational. The whole world, every form of media is second person. It's all you. It's just spoken to you. And I think that in a way, what's been lost actually is we're very good at first person. There's tons of great first person essay writing and there's great casual internet, second person, let's have a conversation. What we've actually lost is kind of that Olympian voice that we used to have. Even the New York Times doesn't have, and NPR don't have an Olympian voice. They don't speak with any much authority anymore. They speak much more casually. I don't think that's really recoverable. I don't think it's, unless you're the Pope. The Pope, I think, has that. He brought that.
And so the question is, should the Pope have a podcast?
We were talking about that. His English is not good enough for a podcast. I actually felt watching the Pope, this is quite sacrilegious, but I'm Jewish, so it's not that sacrilegious, it felt like an episode of Veep, if any of you watched it, because I, listening to it, wasn't sure what he was saying most of the time, and I think there were moments where members of Congress stood up and clapped, and they weren't exactly sure what they were clapping for. It could have been for getting rid of the death penalty, but it might have been getting rid of abortion, and they was just, they just didn't know when they made their bet, but you can imagine one of them picking the wrong side.
The two things I want to, in terms of, you've spoken very highly of podcasts, and I think that it's very fair to say that you're a pioneer of podcasts. I remember, this is a slight aside, but Brandon and I did a stint at the Minneapolis Institute of Arts back in like 2012, and somebody
there. Is that what they're called, MIA?
Yes, yeah.
Wow.
Yes.
that problematic? No, yeah. Now they've changed it. Now it's Mia, which I don't know if that's better or worse. The point is that they, I remember a really high up person that we were developing a podcast for them, and they said, hasn't this whole podcast thing kind of run its course? And so just, you know, 3 years later, on Brendan and my behalf, if you don't mind responding to that former employer, let us go then eventually.
Yeah, I feel like there's apparently, apocryphally, I don't know if this is actually true, but in the 80s, there was an LA, local LA TV station that set up outside a supermarket in Los Angeles and asked every person who came out, how's your screenplay going? And you know, most people were like, oh, you know, it's good. I have that with my agent. But I sort of feel that way about podcasts. And you could stop any person on the street and ask them how their podcast is going. And most of them would be like, oh, it's really good. It's, you know, it's number 78 on the iTunes health list. I mean, podcasts is such a glory day. Every day someone points out some podcast to me that is just so incredible and vivid and such great storytelling. And I can't believe how great it is.
And that's so interesting because that's, in some ways, a very old media, right? Like, to go back to audio days versus, I mean, you've had a career in new media. And so is it just that sort of what's old is new again, or?
Part of it is, and also it's very hard to add media which has to push something else out. So anything you read really has to be, it has to take the place of something else that you've read or some other thing you were doing, but podcasting can be additive. It's the one medium that you can do while doing something else. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what's been its great secret sauce, is that I'm sure those of you who listen to podcasts, you listen to the gym, you listen while you're out for a walk, you listen while you're doing chores. Right? Yes, I'm sure that's true. And that was a great void to a space to fill, and that's why podcasting is so much better than everyone wants to get into digital video online. But video online is just horrible because you have to pay attention to it. Podcasting, you don't have to pay attention. It's great.
So last thing, and again, I promise we're going to turn it over to you all in the second half of questions, but I did want to ask you, because we've been here and the Pope's been here all week, and you read every word of the Bible, and so have you been, I don't know, I've been to some degree surprised, I'll be transparent, and sort of what a big deal it has been for folks, and sort of what a momentous thing, and not just sort of the city shutting down, but this really sort of momentous feeling people have had about this.
Yeah, I mean, it's been amazing, I think. I've, you know, as a secular Jew, been moved. It's my colleague John Dickerson was saying, it's like the closest experience you can have to seeing a Christ-like figure. That he really, it's what he said about all the stuff about climate change and immigration and all that stuff, it's fine, great, whatever. But to me, what's the extraordinary thing about him is the actual human behavior, the connecting with the least, the genuine humility with which he moves through the world, which you never see in Trump world, right? You just never see that anymore. And it was inspiring and also rebuking all at once.
Similar question before, is it then a pivot moment, or is it just a nice vacation from Trump universe that we all live in now?
I'm sure it's just a vacation.
Oh, good. The last piece I would ask about this is just in that having sort of having the Pope here and having a lot of people care about this, and you noted you're a secular Jew, that's sort of this rising tide of the vast majority now of young folks are secular Jews. Congratulations. I don't know, I guess that, you know, trying to tie all of this together in a terribly roundabout way, that's sort of, in a lot of ways, what that fear, that stuff that you're talking about, conservatives get really worked up about, is that the world is changing around them. So should they be afraid? Shouldn't they be somewhat concerned about the fact that the world that they knew is changing? I guess that's always true.
It's changing, it's not the same.
It's the sense that the world is, and particularly like this rising tide, I always think it's interesting, politics, we fight over these things and yet the world completely changes around it, right? So like we have John Boehner who, in, as you pointed out, could shut down the government over Planned Parenthood, and yet we're gonna move much more towards a society, it seems like, that's more progressive and more pro-women's rights and all these kinds of things. And so, I guess if you were saying, where's that energy actually going? Is it just people sort of, you know, fighting against the good night? Is there something that they're fighting against that is something that they can actually do something about, or is it that we should, or should we just give up?
I didn't understand that question, so I'm gonna answer by saying just give up.
Just give up. That's fair. That's fair. I should just ask you about the Nobel Prize sperm bank, but I'll wait till the second half of the show. So, ladies and gentlemen, can we do a big round of applause for David? Everything that we just talked about and bring it to life through entirely unscripted improv comedy theater. So, ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for the Theater of Public Policy. Thank you,
Ben.
Okay, let's turn on the podcast.
This is a global tell-link call from Anand Sayed.
Hi, I'm Sarah Koenig. You've been listening to Serial. Last episode, we talked about a young man who was thrown in jail for murder, a very gory murder. But I got to thinking, if you were stabbed in the throat, would the blood go down your chin? We're going to talk to some people today that are going to graphically describe murder.
Oh, that was so good. That was so good. I love the way she set that up.
I know. Yeah. You're so hot.
Yeah.
If you're making love to this, there's something wrong with you.
Oh my God! His country is going to hell! Listen, having a really nice day, turn on the news, there's a story about this donut shop in Alabama that have real popular donuts and they're only selling two per person. Yeah. Jesus!
Barry, it's gonna be fine.
No! Okay? No! Don't you, why aren't
it's
you?
A brave new world.
No, why aren't you upset? Don't you understand? This is America. People should be able to buy how many donuts they want, whatever they want, it's from whomever they want.
It's a new America, huh? Look out there. It's a bright blue sky and a perfect day. Everything's fine, Barry. You're stuck in the old days. This is new times. You're eating a ham and cheese croissant and you don't even know about it.
Sandy, don't you understand that the blue sky and the sun has been there for millions of years?
It has.
But, no. My world has been open. The fact that we have like 17 news channels. There is shit that I should really be angry about 24/7.
You gotta tone that stuff out, man. Listen, here's an old copy of Nat Geo.
I don't bring a lot of women to Eiffel's pad, but I think you're one of the special ones.
Oh, thank you. It's like 1,000 feet up. This is very, very terrifying. Why would you have a crash pad when you're at a height that's very counterintuitive and it makes me uneasy?
I don't know. I find kind of danger kind of lets the blood flow a little bit.
Maybe. I guess so. I mean,
is that the Arc de Triomphe over there?
Just a sec. What are you doing in my pad?
This isn't even your pad.
Hi, Eiffel. I built this tower. This is mine.
And make me win is a Tesla, eh? What are you doing, Eiffel? Who is this in your pad, eh?
I went to get you some pizza, and this American brings this girl to my place.
Hey, not for me.
Ouch!
You hit the corner of your own tower. You know the design.
This is very uncomfortable. I think I was brought here under maybe some type of misunderstanding.
We will watch if you don't mind.
Yeah. All right, everybody sit down. Everybody sit down. This is the new issue of Vanity Fair, and as we know, our audience base is 113 years old, which is very difficult considering the content of Vanity Fair. So, we have to think about what are the ladies this issue gonna be wearing? Can we talk about like orthopedic shoes? Can they wear shoes anymore if you're 113? Discuss!
I see corsets.
Corsets, why not? They wore them when they were kids.
Retro. This is good. What else?
I like the idea. I think I see lots of shawls.
Shawls.
I see lots of socks.
Socks and shawls, yes. Maybe shawls with printed socks upon them.
What about oven mitts? I mean, they're always burning their hands.
Brassieres. Is there too pointy?
Yeah, we did a survey last issue. They can be too pointy.
That's amazing. Why aren't we writing this down?
There should be a giveaway with every brassiere they get a doily.
For the Davenport, put the doily on the Davenport. After summer.
Hey, Tommy. Well, this is my first summer with you now that mommy's left to go find herself. I know summer vacation, you were thinking like maybe Disneyland?
Or
Universal Studios?
Oh, really? Dad, for real?
Yeah. Well, maybe, but yes, you know what? There's adventure around every corner.
The dog park again.
Yes.
Thank you for coming from the wolf sanctuary. There's a wolf in this bar, and we have to find a way to monetize it. If you speak wolf, if you would do that, I would appreciate that.
The wolf needs something to drink, but I can just keep polishing these glasses.
No, he can have something to drink.
I'm wolf straight from the cave.
Yeah, he used to never approach the wolf from behind.
Okay. Tell me about his demographic.
This wolf...
Okay, well, this
wolf is going to have limited income.
limited income.
Yes, and I feel that...
You don't know me! Yes.
I was afraid of this.
You can't put labels on me! Come on! You think you're better than me?
I don't think I'm better than you.
Come on! You're a predatory pack animal. No, admit it! No, admit it! He's a predatory pack animal. I could have been something! How's it run a little bit?
So thank you so much for coming to my child's birthday party. I mean, it's hard to get a magician at the last minute.
It's no problem. A few little twists.
Sure.
So I'm gonna be doing some magic, but I don't believe in magic. So I'm going to just kind of lead the children through how I would do the trick. So they're going to see it through each step of the process. And then they can go, wow, I would have been impressed.
I'm ready, I just finished my cake. Ooh, this boy looks fun.
All right, you see I have no sleeves whatsoever.
Yeah.
But from the hidden compartment over here, I pull out a wand.
Well, I want to know how it really works. I want to be amazed.
All right, see? Watch as I just slip it back into my shirt and it's gone again.
This birthday sucks.
Do you do anything with cards?
Yes, many different things. Now, pick a card from the trick deck.
I have a delivery. It's the National Geographic's for the old folks' home.
I'm only 112 right now.
Then it's too early.
Now I'm 113. Come on. I gotta tell you something. I don't really read these. Take a look around.
I'm physically unable to read them because I am so young.
My couch is made of National Geographic. Okay? I have a National Geographic TV that I have put an iPad in that plays the National Geographic channel. Yes.
Aren't you learning? I hear that they have centerfolds. Ooh. I mean, don't you?
Can I ask you about that tree? They keep talking about this world's greatest tree that nobody knows where it is, and they took a photo of it. That always worried me.
The only thing I know about the world's greatest tree is it has the world's biggest prickler 100 feet to the right of it. That's all I can see because I'm so young.
But I think you can teach me more than the National Geographic ever could, young person.
So, like, I'm your bridge to the young world, and you're my bridge to the old world.
Yeah, but I'm like most of the infrastructure in the United States. You don't want to actually travel over me.
I am your own personalized media outlet.
Oh, thank Christ.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. God.
All right, so you're going to be walking down this street.
Okay. Talk me through this.
Okay, good. Now, you're walking toward your job.
Okay,
and now you're a lobbyist.
Okay. Ooh, I got to walk straight.
You're right.
Okay.
I know that you are a lobbyist for renewable plastics. So what I want you to think about is how these plastics are going to be biodegrading at such a slow rate that they're really not that much better than real plastics. And then here, by the way, here's an ad from it's a biotin, it's a new kind of shampoo, because I see this new haircut, which I really like. In fact, they're saying that this is going to be a good style for probably about the next 8 months, by which time it will have grown out.
I don't feel good about myself anymore.
No, so take this quiz. This quiz will help you.
Okay.
You know.
What,
according to the Myers-Briggs, you are an INFP as your media outlet, and I'm an ESTJ, so it seems like we wouldn't get along, but you know, opposites attract. Oh, they don't really. If you look at this, psychological study that says we're really drawn toward a more common. Now stand up.
Oh God.
It's the weight of the media is too much.
Oh God.
I'm sorry.
I feel crushed. I don't feel good.
Okay, here's your obituary that I.
Tommy, come on. I told you there was adventure around every corner. Look, it's Snake Island.
In front of them is a deep manhole.
All we have to do is just take the plunge, and who knows what we'll find.
At the bottom of the manhole are a bunch of old magazines.
Do we need like a wristband or to buy admission or anything, Dad? Or we can just go straight down?
We don't need a wristband to explore life.
There's also broken glass.
But we do need some bandages.
Trespassing is fun. We're at the first aid kit.
But what about Syria, Somalia, Eritrea?
So, if I could just try and, I mean, because you're following my model of asking questions. In just the sense of, are you asking in terms of, like, the
what
media?
What can you add to those discussions where we're having global public policy in places where it's very difficult?
What can I add?
Yeah.
Not that much. I mean, those are the Syria situation is the worst. I find Syria to be worse than Iraq. I mean, Iraq was a problem which was largely of our own making, and we there were sort of remedies, but I look at Syria and don't see anything that that is remotely like a solution out there. We're not going to invade Syria. If we did invade Syria, it's not clear what would happen. We don't are not willing to put in the resources to take in all of the refugees. It's a fight between truly awful versus even worse than that. So I got nothing for you. It's awful. I mean, it's beyond awful. I think the best we can do is do humanitarian sort of provide humanitarian relief to Turkey and Jordan and Lebanon and Iran to help them house the people who have to flee. Really, that was grim. That was like
it's a smart audience. So other questions? Yes, right here.
I'll follow up on that. Well, what's going to happen? Why would that stop us from invading any place?
Was that a question?
Why would it stop us?
Why would it? That was a rhetorical. That's a serious question. A rhetorical question.
Yeah. Take it serious.
It would. Well, I think under certain presidents that we could have in 2017, we could invade Syria for just that reason, or Iran maybe. Why not? You know, we could have a royal flush over there. Take every country you have, just one by one. I think the one good thing that the Iraq War produced is a sense of maybe humility about what ground invasions of countries can do, I hope.
Not because I'm trying to shift this conversation to something very but since we brought up the Republican presidential candidate, I mean, my question is, this is this amazing sort of cast of characters you have that are doing all these amazing things, saying these amazing things. Do you ever, I mean, I know you get to talk about it every week, but do you ever think to yourself, man, I actually think this would be really a fun one to cover because it's so chaotic and so different?
Well, it is different. This is a really exciting race in the way that the 2008 race was for Democrats. In 2008, at least, it was really inspiring. This one is just bizarre. You talk to people who are real deep experts, and they have no idea what is going to happen. They are truly confounded by the level of support that persists for Trump and Carson and now Fiorina. And I think the kind of conventional wisdom is now coalescing around the idea that, oh, Marco Rubio just gets to sneak through. It'll be Rubio. Eventually the party apparatus will kind of come around to him and he'll be the nominee. But it's so...
Is that like
so
conventional weird. Wisdom from the last, like, week?
Yeah, like last 2 days. Like 2 days, not even a week. 2 days. 2 days. The Trumpness I don't know. I've never seen anything like it. I would have loved to see what your congressman said about him last night. It is so strange. I think we're over it. I think we're on the backside of that peak. But
do you have a theory as to what it is?
I think there are a lot of anxious old white people who are really upset with, go back to your question last time, who are really upset with how the country is changing and have developed these just completely wrong-headed ideas about what immigration does and about what diversity is, and they have gotten very loud and very anxious, and they have found in Trump somebody who has tons of money and absolutely no shame and is not held accountable for what he says. So that's a great recipe. I think we're vulnerable. We as a nation, we're vulnerable to this kind of demagoguery in a way that we haven't been for, you know, for a century at least.
Other questions, other hands. So yes, right here, and then I'll zip around.
Given the changing landscape of media, what advice would you give to young journalists?
Oh, it's so great. This is the best time to be a it is so
really?
Oh, jobs everywhere. There are jobs galore.
I started out my career thinking that I was going to be a journalist, and I actually wrote for the South Florida Sun Sentinel as sort of like a team position. And there was someone who read my column as a high schooler in the Sun Sentinel?
Is it called the Danger Zone?
No. Yeah. But I'm not joking when I say that my editor at the time, who had been in the business for 20 plus years, almost literally like grabbed me and said, get out while you still can. Like, this whole ship's going down and it's too late for me. You can have something, you can make something of yourself.
No, he was so wrong. I mean, maybe if the South Florida Sun Sentinel is true, that's probably one of the places where you don't want to be. A regional newspaper is not the place to be. But there are so many opportunities in digital media now. If you have any kind of moxie, if you're just willing to try, there is an enormous amount that you can do. And now these things are profitable. BuzzFeed is a newsroom of 1,000 people. Business Insider is 400. These places you've never heard of are growing like weeds, and they are trying new stuff all the time. There are new forms being invented, like the podcasting. If you're somebody who went into radio 5 years ago and you thought this is kind of like dying, radio's kind of dying, but I would really like to work for NPR. NPR producers, it's like being a Google, a developer at Google or Facebook now. Those guys are getting poached every second because there's so many new podcast operations that want experienced audio producers. It's glory days.
Can I ask a question there? You say that there's a lot of positions available, and if you have like kind of the moxie and the marketing and branding and stuff. But the stuff a lot of times that some writers are given, for the first God knows how many years when they start, is like, hey, can you do this for me? It's not paid, but it's a good way to get your name out there. I mean, when you say that there's work, is it compensated?
Yeah, that 5 years ago it was, we're gonna exploit the hell out of you. We're not gonna pay you, but look, you're gonna have to.
And not at Slate, though, of course.
Slate. Well, we had unpaid internships back in the day, no longer. But no, now actually there's so much demand that those jobs have money attached to them. So it's not, I'm not saying that every single person who wants to be a journalist is getting a great job as a journalist, but that is not true. But they're all the gloom and doom, oh, there's nothing left, it's all dying, that is just, it's totally over. There is such a flowering of new things, and you have people. I mean, I was having lunch with at lunch yesterday with Ezra Klein, who's a friend of mine, and he Ezra Klein is somebody who's like basically like a kind of college ne'er-do-well who decided he was going to blog, and he was really smart about he invented this new form of blogging, entirely new way of approaching the world. He himself, just a college kid, invents this. Becomes an incredibly successful blogger, has started this site Vox, which has just exploded and created a new form of explanatory journalism. And so there's not necessarily, I think what's great is that if you, there aren't these sort of institutions that you have to enter and follow specific set career paths and have to go from A to B to C. Now there's all sorts of kinds of ferment and cool stuff happening, and a lot of it pays, not all of it, but most of it really does pay.
Cool.
So it's good.
So there were several, I'll go here and then up there, yeah.
Hi, I have a subscription to National Geographic. Anyway, I wanted to ask about, so one of the appeals of the magazine is that you get to go to all of these amazing places that maybe you would never have gone, but we live in a world in which all those places are much more tangible than they were even 10 years ago, 20 years ago. So do you see any room for, or do you think, is there any room for like that kind of like investigation like of a mega transect that's like Central Africa like existing in a world in which we can go there and it's not, and people have cell phones there?
Because the world is shrinking,
yeah.
Sure.
I think, yeah, I mean, I still think there are places. So the person who founded Atlas Obscura is this guy named Joshua Four, and he's incredible. He wrote this great book about memory called Moon Walking with Einstein. But right now he's doing a book about hunter-gatherers, and he's doing a book about pygmies. And he, right now Josh is in Congo living with pygmies. And you can say, like, oh, the world's really close, we can all get to Congo or whatever, but you can't. The number of people who have actually gone and lived with pygmies, very few. And when Josh comes out, and they're all very small, when Josh's book comes out, everyone's going to be amazed that he has found this thing which actually people don't know. But I think, I mean, does that answer, is that what you were asking about? Is that right or no? Is that not the right answer to this?
There's a piece, in terms of what Atlas Obscura does, it seems almost a mirror of that then, in that we can get anywhere and yet we're overlooking things in our
right.
own world.
Right, right, that's exactly right. I mean, so in my view, there's this great line, I can't remember who it is, but it's sort of about, what's the difference between you at home and you on vacation? And is it, when you're on vacation, you're always seeing new things, like you're excited about what you see, it's thrilling to you. But really, like if you go on vacation in San Francisco. San Francisco is a beautiful city, but it's no more beautiful than Washington. It doesn't have that, it's no more intrinsically interesting than Washington is. It's just different, it's a new sight. What's different on vacation is not the place you are, it's you. Like you become a different person when you travel. And it's an act of will to sort of say, I'm not going to just look for variety and look for new experiences and look for discovery when I'm abroad. I'm going to do it here. And when you decide to do that, it's a very cool thing that can happen. And you end up doing weird stuff and seeing amazing things. And you can see the broken needles and the you know, the broken glass at the bottom of the sewer, which would be pretty awesome. That's where we're going later, kids.
I think, did I see a hand up here? Yes.
So I have a question that is potentially less depressing than Syria, but more depressing than the state of journalism in America, which is academic history in the U.S. Can you talk a little bit about the importance of having an awareness of American history, or history generally? I'm an Americanist, so I assume that American history is the only important history. That's me. Can you talk a little bit about the importance of knowing history?
I mean, certainly, like, to me, there's my John Dickerson, who does this political podcast with me for Slate, is now host of Face the Nation. He does another podcast called Whistle Stop, which is a podcast about American presidential campaign history. And what's incredible is that each time, each podcast he does, he's whether he's going back to the William Henry Harrison campaign of 1840. Or to Ross Perot's campaign in 1992, or to Ronald Reagan's campaign. Each time you read it, and you realize, like, you know, the history is history as echo, or the present as echo of history. And John's and political analysis is so incredibly rich because he has this expansive sense of what has happened before, and that's in the case of politics. And that's true in every subject. I don't think it's necessary to make the case for it. It's so self-evidently true that you need an understanding and knowledge of the history of the world you live in for it to really be significant and meaningful. That's like obviously true.
Does that answer your question? Was there something that drove you to ask that question that inspired you to ask that in particular?
What drove me personally is that I'm getting a PhD and I have no hope. right? as much as you're like, oh, it's a great time to be a journalist. Like,
that's a terrible time to be in the story. But,
I was there. And so I was hoping you could be like, no, it's awesome, trust me.
No, it's not awesome. No, I mean, but if you write, you know, if you have some like popular history to write, you have a popular history.
Do you have a focus? Because I know when you get to a PhD level, it has to be like the days of 1776 between September
20th. I study medical history from roughly the Civil War to World War I, particularly cardiac problems and Civil War soldiers.
Wow.
Can you convince me that it's okay to be a historian the way you convinced somebody else that it was okay to be a journalist?
Well, I don't mean it's obviously great to be a historian. It's much harder that there are not that many jobs. But why don't you let's see, what can you do with that?
I love that we're workshopping the audience.
She can do a podcast. Go work in Frederick at the American Civil War Medical Advancement Museum.
Were you guys there?
I was there for a wedding last week. No, the wedding didn't take place.
I am losing control. Yes.
If it helps you, and I have a PhD and I'm sitting here.
If I can just broaden this out to the minority of the audience that doesn't have a PhD in Civil War medical technology, to ask you sort of as a wrapping up question here, I love all of the stuff we've talked about with Atlas Obscura and with history and with politics, and so if you were to sort of give folks a parting wisdom or parting advice in terms of this exploring, or what should we be doing if we are all explorers? What would we
do? Like, go and explore. you should be reading Atlas Obscura and getting our email. But I actually, truly, on this Atlas Obscura point, I really just think it is an act of will, and to sort of say, what is some place in Washington that will surprise me that I haven't been, or that I could take an expedition to? That will be, we like the other week we went out to Berkeley Springs, West Virginia. I don't know if anyone's been there.
Yeah.
Berkeley Springs, which was America's first kind of like a summer vacation resort scam, real estate scam deal. George Washington got all these founding fathers together to buy all the land around Berkeley Springs, and it's like a nothing little town, but it has this bathhouse, which is an incredible bathhouse where you get to go bathe in this heated spring water. And don't stop that. Stop your insinuations.
And we're just simple folk from Minnesota.
And they kept George Washington's actual bathtub there, and there it is in the middle of nowhere in particular. It's this wonderful little place. You can just drive out a couple hours and you're there.
And so go to West Virginia, and also to other places, find our own things,
yes,
and then submit them to Atlas Obscura.
Sure. Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, can we do a tremendous? One last time, so just as promised, everything is made up on the spot, entirely improvised. So be generous and make a big round of applause for the Theater of Public Policy!
What I need, boy, is a printing press. And I got you a deal if you want it. You want it. It's two for the price of one on these printing presses. They're a hot commodity, I tell you what.
Wow. Thank you so much. I would love to have one.
Well, good.
I brought my parchment paper with me and my quiver.
Look at you! And what's the theme of your newspaper?
It's going to be all about horses.
Oh, that'll sell like hotcakes.
Yeah, what? How they're going to change the economy.
Any noble steeds in particular you plan to write about? Or any riding with Larry kind of subject matter?
Do I look like a PhD? I don't know much about actual horses.
That's fair. That's fair.
But I've spelled the word horses. Let's see how this works.
All right, one copy done, that's a nickel. But you can do a few more copies and you'll have yourself a dollar bill.
Oh, wow, well, thank you, sir. I appreciate this, although I don't think printing is really going to go anywhere.
Guys, thank you guys so much for tuning in to my new podcast. It's title of this podcast is That Shoe Didn't Fit. It's about all the relationships I've had that did not go anywhere. One of my guests that I'd be having with me today is a gentleman I dated in high school. I tracked him down through Facebook. Thank you so much for being here, Mike. It's a real honor to have you.
Yeah.
So what happened with us?
Well, I caught you cheating on me.
That's right.
Well, I confronted you about it, and I think I was pretty clear at the time how it made me feel.
Yeah.
I was pretty mad.
Right. To be fair, you should probably have knocked on your mom's, like, laundry room door before just barging in.
You said you had a surprise for me after school.
Mr. Thompson, Ms. Thompson, it's well past 10 o'clock. You guys said you're going to be back at night. I've got a lot of homework, so if you could just take your kid out of the closet. I'd like to go home now. Okay? You guys were out like way past the time you said you were going to be. I don't even want to be a babysitter anymore. Okay? I don't even believe in my job.
We'll pay you for the overtime.
No. No. You make
you block the kid. That seems more important than our. Oh, come here, Ashley. Come here.
I don't trust anyone.
She's going to become a Republican now.
So, you want to be a history major, do you?
I do, very
get
much.
Get a master's, maybe a PhD?
I do, very much.
Give me one undocumented primary source right now.
I don't have anything on me. I mean,
you got a secondary source?
I'm sure I could come up with something if you gave me access to a library or archives of some kind. I mean, am I supposed to carry this with me? That seems irresponsible, especially if it's a primary source.
You got any public history? Doing some interviews, talk to the local populace.
Why are you being so mean to me? Is this how you filter out everybody who wants to be an historian?
You threatened me. There's not a lot of jobs here, and you might take mine.
You're not even emphasizing the...
So, I'm really happy to have this date. You seem like a really nice person, and I would just like to hang out a little bit more often, if you wouldn't mind.
What can you offer me in terms of love?
I'd have a heart. I'd have a future.
Do you think this relationship will go anywhere tonight, or should I leave?
I think it could go places, but I have no way of proving that it will. It's going to require your actions and my actions combined to make dual action.
Do you have any documentation certifying your health and cleanliness?
I have medical records, and I drew pictures of what our night may end up like. That's you on the bottom, and that's me making you cheesecake.
I'd like to give you a PhD right now.
Okay, this is your big break in National Geographic. You are going to go live amongst the angry white men. Right. Okay, there's two of them over there.
There's a war on Christmas! Why?
Get in there!
Don't you understand? Hillary deleted every single possible guy in
the I like it!
Oh, good! It just makes you better.
He's ready. Welcome everybody to
our first taping. This is going to be very exciting for our new season show. In the proud tradition of Friends and How I Met Your Mother, we are going to have a zany cast of characters come up here. It's the GOP lineup. Who's going to win? Who's going to end up dating whom? I don't know.
I want to make America great again. It's a baseball hat that I wear to cover up my ridiculous hair.
Have I told you about my immigrant grandfather?
Oh, here we go again! Here we go again!
It's a great story.
Here's some water. Real thirsty there. Did your grandfather teach you how to drink water?
It's not very nice.
No, it's not nice. What do you think, Fiorina?
A burn dinner again.
Just whoa, like you burned Hewlett-Packard and everything.
I gave everything that I had to that company, and many people believe in me.
Oh, I bet you have. And I've only declared bankruptcy a few times. Don't worry about old Donnie boy. Everything is fine.
Take off that stupid hat.
I can't, my hair falls down.
Welcome to the Spirit. We're so glad to have you people. That's so great.
We're men, we're called men.
It's just, you know, times are a changing. Forgive me for my prejudices.
No, I'm pretty sure that we're men.
Yeah, you identify that way today, but we can even keep up. So, I know that there was a big publicity splash about the sperm bank that had the, you know, the Nobel laureates and the winners and whatnot in them. So that well got a little tapped out, if you know what I mean. So running a little dry these days.
I'm a communications major. I could really just use any type of money, so I'm willing to do it.
So what we have in our stocks now are sort of what we call the B team. It mostly consists of that jerk guy that you dated for a little bit, and then you stopped dating because you listened to your parents. We've got millions of those.
I've never dated.
I came in to donate, and when I mean donate, I mean sell.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm not looking, that's really like.
Paradigm shift, forgive me.
Yeah.
That makes much more sense.
And I'm a historian, I'm writing a history about a sperm.
So, I'm glad you could make it on such short notice. I thought about hiring a magician for the birthday party, but I thought you'd be much better. You could inform the children about what's happening in Syria right now.
That's fine, I've got my briefcase.
Alright, he's here.
Look, you just arrived from somewhere else. This is, remember this.
We just had faith, so they're a little wired, but they should be.
Sure. So kids, what we have here on this table is a far-off place, huh? But everybody's friendly there. Doesn't that sound like a nice place to be?
Can I go there?
You can, if you want to leave your mom and dad.
You have to say goodbye to us. I'm not going there.
Why isn't he going with?
You choose the promise of a new fate or your current ball and chain.
Well, hold on.
You wanted me to be real, Jack.
Yeah,
I gotta speak truth to kids.
I don't know if you need the tough sell. I mean, it's a birthday party, right?
Happy birthday! Run away from your family. That's
fine. How do I get to the new place?
Well, you ask their government to accept you. If they want to, if you smile big enough.
Can I still go to school?
Maybe.
What about all my friends?
Oh, they're not coming.
I don't know if I want to go to this place anymore.
I don't want you to go to that place.
This is not working out. I'm going to have to ask you to leave.
That's
bring in John Dickerson to tell stories. God, can you believe everything that this folk is saying?
I don't.
Yes! Yeah!
Right!
Hey,
good!
Still talking, still.
Okay, I'm gonna hover between my seat and my ass.
Yes! 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 I can't
Congress.
It's us, it's I think.
I urge you go vote and abortion, please.
Whoa!
I understood that word. That's
time for standing ovation.
Yes, and
yeah. America.
Yeah, America, come here. Go.
The tyranny of the West.
Now, Pope Francis, you have to learn to get rid of the accent that we have so proudly bestowed upon you.
Hey, why?
Request for healing, yeah. And you have saved many princesses from the towers, yes?
This is simple!
You see, now it comes the time for you to have your biggest adventure of all.
Ah, to Americano, yes?
Specifically.
Oh, Washington.
No, specifically the adventure. It is not going to be in a box that you will hit. No! It's not going to be down the tube. Adventure is going to be mind, your mind. You have to learn how to speak in a way that the congressmen and the politicians, they will mostly understand, but they will hover somewhere in between affirmation and disagreement.
Yes. I just got over the Argentinian accent to fit to the Italian. It's very confusing for me. I go back to the Argentinian.
Nintendo.
Well, I learned a few facts about me on
Bunny.
I'm done. Welcome to my podcast. And the Gaffer. Today, we talk about me. Today, I'm going to tell you about how when I was a little boy. My grandma, she took me all over with her. With my little tricycle. I know my little tricycle.
I turn it up and I still can't understand it.
Wait, this is the best part.
On my tricycle, I go everything off. And I look at my tricycle.
This was written down, we could read it, Bill. I tell you, this is stupid. Snuggling in this old Italian stereotype podcast has never made me feel sexy.
It's all the other girl that I've ever seen.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Hurry up. We can do anything during the podcast. I can hold you. I can make some pasta. I can listen to two more different ones. I've changed my voter registration 5 times. I'm not paying attention to the moment. Sorry to interrupt this song. The one about the garage behind the Taj Mahal. There's so many options. We just have to go up around the corner to see them.
But why go anywhere when you can sit here and listen to it?
I miss my grandmother.
Oh, yeah.
She was a beautiful, beautiful
woman. Oh, man.
You got nothing, you know.
I'm never going to read the printed word again. Never.
This podcast of The Godfather brought to you by Marbles in the Mouth. Marbles in the Mouth. If you don't want people to understand you, use Marbles in the Mouth.
Time. It's absolutely been our goal to hopefully be able to come back here someday if you all would have us. So if you all enjoy tonight's show, come and find us and talk to us, and we would love to talk to you more about potentially bringing the show back here. We want to say a tremendous thank you, as I did at the top, to the Washington Improv Theater.